Item number, SCP-140. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. SCP-140 must never be brought closer than 15 meters to any source of standard ink, human blood, or other fluids suitable for writing. Any contamination by blood or ink must be reported immediately. Any remaining copies of SCP-140 created during the initial printing must be found and destroyed as soon as possible. Only SCP-140 is to be preserved, for purposes of study, early warning, and cataloging and recording possible SCPs, derived from its subject matter. SCP-140 is contained at Site-76, in a sealed vault containing a single desk. At this time, no research is to be carried out upon the original SCP-140. Researchers are to read from prepared copies not bearing the signature of its author, which lack its properties. In the event of approved research, SCP-140 may not be removed from the vault, and readers may not be in contact with it for longer than 9 hours. Access requires written approval from the head researcher for the explicit purposes of testing. An armed guard stationed outside the vault will meet any attempted theft with deadly force. Should any personnel begin displaying obsession with SCP-140 or signs of possible mimetic contamination, they are to be issued a Class A amnesiac, false memories implanted as necessary, and transferred to another project. Transferred personnel must be monitored for signs of relapse. Description: SCP-140 is a modern hard copy book with an unremarkable black binding and an unknown number of white pages. The book jacket is missing, but the title, A Chronicle of the Devas, is clearly legible. The inside cover is signed by the author, whose name is indecipherable. The text is copyrighted 19... Careful examination reveals there are far more pages between the bindings than could be contained within them. Readers admit to feelings of paranoia, unease, and occasional nausea while reading SCP-140, although this may be related to the subject material. Nonetheless, readers almost universally describe SCP-140 as fascinating and express continued interest, despite its frequently unsettling content. 1 in 15 readers describes SCP-140 as having a faint odor of dried blood. SCP-140 is a detailed account of an ancient civilization originating in what is now South Central Siberia, identified as the Devates. Although, like all cultures, the Devates evolved and changed over time, they appear to have exhibited unusual continuity. Universal fixtures of the Devate culture in all periods includes militarism, conquest, ancestor worship, urban centers ruling over large slave populations, gruesome human sacrifice, and the practice of apparently efficacious thaumaturgic rituals. A variety of relics and creatures produced by the Devate culture would be abnormal or dangerous enough, if the account is to be believed, to qualify for containment in their own right. If SCP-140 comes into contact with any fluid suitable for writing, including human blood, the account of the Devate civilization's history expands. Human blood appears the most potent of possible writing substances, but in any case, the amount of new material does not correspond proportionally to the fluids introduced. Although these new segments sometimes include new descriptions of rituals, or cultural traits or illustrations of previously covered material, they more frequently include new, more recent accounts of information, chronicling the continued history of the Devate civilization, or descriptions of new individuals and artifacts. Formerly decisive defeats become setbacks. New persons and events are inserted. Foundation archaeologists have discovered corresponding new artifacts and traces of the Devate civilization in applicable locations and strata, in some cases found in dig sites that had already been thoroughly explored. Although at times the Devates were a collection of city-states, they appear to have consistently returned to imperialism under a theocratic aristocracy, the Deva, practitioners of cannibalism and thaumaturgy. Although initially Foundation researchers believed the Deva to have been a hereditary class recycling the names of noteworthy individuals, evidence and the events of now suggest that the Deva possessed preternatural longevity as a result of data expunged. Several researchers, notably Professor, have concluded the Deva were so divergent from modern humans as to be a separate subspecies, a conclusion supported by graphic representations within SCP-140, and data expunged. SCP-140 is remarkably detailed by the standards of a primary source, seeming closer to a biography than a historic text. It includes lurid descriptions of sacrificial rites, battlefield descriptions, daily life, and the life stories of various noteworthy individuals, including quotes and dates of birth. Several distinct individuals have been identified, including the individual presently termed SCP-140-A, of which only are accounted for by recorded deaths. Foundation archaeologists have discovered several sites containing ruins consistent with the supposed Davite culture in various locations across Siberia, northern Iran, and Mongolia. Artifacts and traces of intercultural conflict and contact have been discovered as far west as the Carpathian Mountains and as far east as northern Pakistan and China. These include SCP. Addendum 140A. SCP-140 was originally found in the office of a deceased historian. The previous owner was discovered in his office at University, having expired from self-inflicted lacerations on both wrists. There were no traces of their blood in the office. The subject's colleagues claimed during interviews they discovered a note in faded ink in their handwriting next to SCP-140. All witnesses were administered Class A amnesiacs and false memories implanted. The note read, "I have to know. I'm sorry." All texts within 15 meters, except several books relating to the history of the region, were blank. The remaining books now included accounts of supposed interaction between the Davite civilization and the subject cultures, or applicable discussions of Davite history and culture. These texts were confiscated. All printed forms and media were blank. All pens, printers, and ink cartridges were empty. Addendum 140B. Although SCP-140 was published during the 20th century, the tone of the book suggests it is a recounting of events, individuals, and practices experienced firsthand by SCP-140's unknown author. Foundation investigators have tracked SCP-140's publication to the data expunged printing house and a batch of several copies self-published by a wealthy individual, hereby termed SCP-140-A. SCP-140-A's signature on the contract matches the strange signature inside SCP-140. More than 40 of the copies produced in this batch were apparently leached of all ink by the remaining copies. To date, Foundation agents have recovered and destroyed the majority of the remainder, but some remain at large. Two expansion events have been reported during periods when SCP-140 had never been exposed to fluids of any sort, or removed from its vault. An investigation and manhunt for the author of SCP-140 is ongoing. Addendum 140C. Through study of SCP-140 and other contained objects related to the Davite civilization, Foundation researchers have concluded that, transposed to the modern era, the resurgence of a hostile Davite civilization in history, more recent than CE, would constitute a grave and even possibly retroactive threat to the Foundation and modern civilization as we know it. Even best-case projections of Davite resurgence in the modern day suggest a CK-class restructuring of modern society and a worldwide conflict with a projected death toll of at least expunged and an end to the Foundation's secrecy. Addendum 140D. Its journal, found on his home PC, indicates that upon his initial reading of SCP-140, it ended with the almost utter destruction of the Davite civilization and the genocide of all known Deva in 200 BCE by the forces of Chinese General Qin Kai. As a result of subsequent containment breaches, including those detailed in the journal, copious quantities of new material have been added, describing survivors regrouping and migrating to another region of central Siberia, rebuilding their empire steadily and continuing to advance culturally and technologically. At present, the empire is described as having finally been crushed by Genghis Khan during the early period of his conquests, although the fates of many important persons in several cities remain ambiguous. Foundation archaeologists will be dispatched for investigation and research. Addendum 140E. After an incident at an undisclosed dig site resulting in countless casualties, all Foundation archaeologists excavating sites of suspected Daevite artifacts or ruins are to be accompanied by a fully armed security team. SCP-141 has been neutralized. SCP-142 remains at large. All other anomalous contacts and artifacts were destroyed when the dig site was struck by a cruise missile. Agent received a commendation and was treated for post-traumatic stress disorder. Dr. received a posthumous commendation for courage. An investigation into the possible involvement of SCP-140A or their agents in these events is ongoing. Item number, SCP-141. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. When not in use, SCP-141 is to be stored inside a locked safe in Site 76. Access to this safe requires security level clearance 3 or higher, and written approval to use SCP-141. When SCP-141 is in use, either for implementation in accordance with Foundation goals, or for research purposes, it is to be kept within the possession of the assigned researcher at all times. Failure to account for SCP-141 will result in a severe reprimand. While SCP-141's danger to the Foundation appears limited, it could still be a tempting target for certain subversive groups or opportunistic users. For this reason, SCP-141 is to be checked out for no more than 1 week at a time. Description: SCP-141 is a small leather-bound codex dating back to Roman times, easily carried in one hand. Despite its great age, it never acquires any additional signs of wear and tear beyond a somewhat aged-looking cover. Its thin papyrus pages are always crisp, and so far have proven difficult to tear from the codex's binding. All attempts at radiocarbon dating have failed. The judgment of SCP-141 as being Roman in origin was initially based upon its appearance, but later confirmed through extensive research using SCP-141, corroborated by historical records. The title is apparently Codex Damnatio, based upon the text on its spine. SCP-141's pages are written in Roman Republic-era Latin. It is a detailed description of notes and summations for a wide range of legal trials. This first half contains a series of historic trials from throughout history. The earliest trial appears to be from the prescriptions of the late Roman Republic, while the most recent case is the Data Expunged, taking place in 2000. Each case summary is extensive, with precise witness quotations, exact physical descriptions of evidence, and their importance to the case, and so on. The Codex actually contains far more legal cases than its 150 pages could possibly allow. A reader must make a detailed reference to a range or specific case to discover if it is listed inside. If it is, the pages will transform into those relating to the specified case. This requires specific mentions of historical context surrounding the cases. Research with SCP-141 conducted by Professor revealed SCP-141 has apparently been employed in, among other important periods, a wide variety of Roman prescriptions, heretical trials of the Catholic Church, the Spanish Inquisition, the witch hunts of the 17th century, and the Red Scare of the mid-20th century. The latter half of the book is blank and can be written in with any pen with black ink. A user of SCP-141 must provide detailed information about a criminal proceeding, including victim, evidence, witness statements, and suspects, and they must do so in Republic-era Latin. Later readings of the book will reveal these new cases in the first half of the book, written in the same handwriting as the rest. A very precise, careful hand. When this information is provided to SCP-141, the particulars of the case described in SCP-141 appear to become true in regards to memory and evidence surrounding the case. Witnesses' memories and testimony will correspond to the information written in SCP-141. Falsified evidence springs into existence in accordance with its description, usually appearing in the court record or the crime scene where it can easily be discovered. This has included murder weapons, suspicious traces of the subject such as fluids or fingerprints, stolen items, or incriminating documents. SCP-141 appears able to cause criminal activities that would not have taken place, although this requires even more precise wording and description of the particulars. The guilty party specified by SCP-141 may have a false memory implanted that corresponds with SCP-141's account of events, although this result requires a clever description of the desired scenario. These memories do not overwrite the original ones, but they do seem quite nearly as real. Care must be taken by all users to ensure as many loopholes are closed as possible. SCP-141's falsifications will stand up to all but the most critical of examinations, but it will only produce precisely the memories and evidence written inside it. While it appears to prejudice the court against the guilty party, this is not foolproof. Nonetheless, successfully employed, SCP-141 is an almost surefire conviction. Even in the event of exoneration, guilty subjects will often still be ostracized and viewed as guilty by influenced witnesses and law enforcement personnel, who may in some cases data expunged. Addendum SCP-141-A. Tests are ongoing to determine if SCP-141 is capable of exonerating an innocent man wrongly convicted, or if changing the results during the trial has any measurable effect. Approval to employ SCP-141 in a test case is pending. Addendum SCP-141-B. Following data expunged, all test cases involving Foundation disciplinary hearings or implicating members of the Foundation, other than D-Class personnel without signed waivers from the guilty subject, are hereby forbidden by O5. Violation of this new security protocol shall be dealt with harshly. Item number SCP-152. Object Class Safe. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-152 is to be kept in a locked chamber in Site 49, henceforth referred to as the Reading Room. The Reading Room is off-limits to personnel below Clearance Level 2. The Reading Room will be equipped with one ceiling lamp, one security camera, one scanner, copier, printer, to be restocked with paper and ink as needed, one standard office chair, and one standard office desk, upon which SCP-152 will rest. When not in use, SCP-152 is to be turned to its last page so that any additions made to it can be immediately observed. A single guard will be posted outside of the reading room to deter unauthorized persons from entering the reading room. All personnel are advised to remain quiet if they are near the reading room. Description: SCP-152 is a large hardbound book with leather bindings. The paper inside resembles vellum and is written upon in black ink. The contents of the book consist entirely of a series of entries that describe apocalyptic events, which are not always XK class end of the world scenarios, but invariably deal with the extinction of humanity. The entries are arranged in chronological order, beginning with an unexplained spontaneous failure of the sun in 6000 BC, and ending with other events close to the present day. Many of the entries describe apocalypses caused or facilitated by objects that are or were in Foundation custody, or are of a paranormal nature. There are also records of human extinction caused by more conventional means, such as nuclear warfare or deadly viral epidemics. Each entry describes in some detail the events leading up to the calamity itself, and the aftermath until the point at which the last human on Earth dies. It has been observed that the entries in SCP-152 change to whatever language the reader is most comfortable with, up to the point where the sentence structure can change significantly from reader to reader, or even begin using colloquialisms that only the reader would understand. Only the basic meaning of the entries remains constant. If multiple people are looking at SCP-152, it will read in the personal language of whomever began reading first. If no one is directly observing SCP-152, it will display the language of whomever read it last. Rarely, words will appear in the book that do not translate, and instead appear as horizontally arranged calligraphic characters, which have not been matched to any known language. To the best knowledge of Foundation historians, most of the information contained in SCP-152 is accurate, diverging only at the point where the apocalypse occurs. In almost all cases, the difference is that a few key decisions were apparently made differently in SCP-152's version of history, leading ultimately to humankind's annihilation. SCP-152 resists all attempts to change or write in it. Inks, graphite, charcoal, and other marking materials do not adhere to the pages, and are easily brushed off. Lasers or other heat sources do not burn into the paper. Close inspection has revealed that foreign substances are stopped from actually coming into contact with the pages. At least 5 micrometers of empty space are always present between the pages themselves and any foreign materials that might come into contact with them. For this reason, SCP-152 does not decay, which also means that it is proven impossible to determine SCP-152's exact age. SCP-152 is self-updating, with newly inked entries and new descriptions of how the last human died appearing at unpredictable intervals, always on the last page of the book. The date that a new entry appears corresponds with the date given in the entry for the death of the last member of the human species. When space becomes an issue, extra pages appear along with the text, and the spine of SCP-152 broadens accordingly. There have been several updates to the book since it came into Foundation custody. As with past events, SCP-152 has proven to be up to date on current events, until a point at which a catastrophe occurs. Because recent entries frequently concern entities or groups of interest to the Foundation, including the Foundation itself, SCP-152 is to be checked regularly for any information of importance. Addendum 1. With the acknowledgement made that letting this thing lie around where the public could find it is dangerous to us, is there any real reason to study it? Outdated hypothetical disaster scenarios aren't our concern. We've got plenty of real ones in the present to deal with. 05. Addendum 2. The book is accurate enough about pre-disaster Earth that it makes a decent guide to the present. Plus, it gives a little perspective on the big picture of what some SCPs could do if they got loose. I think all researchers with clearance ought to read the last 50 pages or so just to drive home how important what they do here is. For want of a nail, and all that. Dr. Jansen. Addendum 3. Jansen, half the entries in the last 50 pages show the Foundation screwing up and killing everybody. 05. Addendum 4. Like I said, it gives a little perspective. Dr. Jansen. Incident Report 152-05. On the night of the security guard on camera duty noticed that SCP-152 was missing from the reading room. However, by the time she had finished reaching for the switchboard to report this, SCP-152 had reappeared, and there was a new entry on the last page. As this was the 5th such occurrence of sudden disappearance and reappearance, a simple test was conducted with a high-speed camera, a sensitive electronic scale upon which SCP-152 was placed, and an alarm set to go off if the weight upon the scale abruptly changed. The next 3 updates to SCP-152 all set the alarm off, and the high-speed camera revealed that SCP-152 vanished from sight for exactly 1 second each time. Addendum 5. I posit that the book isn't actually being updated as such. It's actually being replaced, and each time it changes, we are actually receiving a new edition of it. I would very much like to find out where these are coming from. Dr. Jansen. Item number, SCP-095. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-095 is to be placed in a standard polyethylene sleeve when not under scheduled research, and stored in a standard locked filing cabinet to prevent damage or wear. High-resolution digital scans are available for any level 1 and above personnel who wish to view SCP-095. Description. SCP-095 appears to be a set of 3 moderately aged black and white comic books, printed in 1932. The front and rear covers are missing, and several pages have been rendered illegible due to water damage. It was found by Agent in a small antique shop in Denver, Colorado, and purchased for a small fee without incident. The owner of the shop had apparently not read the item past the publisher's date on the first page. Forensic inspections of SCP-095 have revealed it to be genuine, though completely unremarkable save for its content. It is printed on cheap pulp paper and inked with dyes common to other publications of its era. The publisher's stamp indicates it was produced by Future Funnies, a company operating out of the town of Purple Lake, Ohio. All research and inquiries thus far have shown both the company and the town to be completely non-existent. The comic itself is a pulp science fiction story entitled The Atomic Adventures of Ronnie Raygun, featuring a lead character bearing an unmistakable resemblance to former United States President Ronald Reagan. Each story opens with a large panel reading, "In the far-fetched future world of the 1980s, only Ronnie Raygun can save the day." It appears to follow an episodic format, with one self-contained story per publication. The three stories are briefly described below. Ronnie vs. Space Admiral Carter. This story pits Planetary Governor Ronnie Raygun and his sidekick, Space Major Herbert, against the titular Space Admiral Carter, as they both vie for the position of Space Marshal. The events loosely follow the events of the 1980 presidential election. Space Assassin. This story follows a character named Spaceman Hinckley as he prepares to assassinate Space Marshal Raygun. He manages to catch Raygun by surprise and wound him with his Devastator Ray, before being subdued by Raygun's soldiers. The events obviously refer to the 1981 assassination attempt by John Hinckley Jr. Jungle Planet. This story follows Raygun's attempts to create an army of robots on the jungle-covered planet of Nika in order to protect it from the evil Sand Bandits. Although Raygun is told that he will lose his command if he interferes with events on planet Nika, he sends his lieutenant, Space Colonel West, to secretly build a force under the cover of the jungle. When their plan is discovered, Space Colonel West publicly takes the blame and saves his superior. The storyline appears to be a simplified retelling of the Iran-Contra controversies of 1986. Possibly most interesting is the final page of each book, which advertises other stories published by future funnies. Investigation is underway to locate any surviving copies at once. The advertised stories are listed below. Space Major Herbert assumes command. Starman Willy versus the Space Succubus. Globe Walker in Sneak Attack. Barry Beetlejuice on Planet Afgar. Diamond Donnie in Putting on the Ritz. Sky Marm Sarah of the Ice World. Flying Franken versus Rocket Rush. Star Command Proton in a Losing Battle. The New Menace, Death to Mankind. Personal Log of Dr. Date, October 6th, 2004. I don't think I need to emphasize how important it is to recover any and all of the advertised stories immediately, the final two in particular. Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.